very good news.
Dear guests, we want to start with the ceremony first of for the initial Nobel ceremony for the Congress. Instead of that, we will count in advance the first keynote address from our distinguished keynote lecturer, Josh Paxinos. After that, we will have a short break, and then we will have all the welcome messages for the Congress. This is due to a delay of the Minister of Health. So, Professor Josh Paxinos completed his BA at the University of California at Berkeley, his PhD at McGill University, and spent a postdoctoral year at Yale University. He and Charles Watson are the authors of The Rat Brain in Stereotaxic Coordinates. With over 50,000 citations across in 7 editions, it is the third most cited book in science after Molecular Cloning and the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Professor Paxinos has also published another 45 books on the structure of the brain of humans and experimental animals, his most recent being MRI-DTI Atlas of the Rat Brain. His work was recognized by an AO Ramazzotti Medal, Humboldt Prize, a $4 million NHMRC Australia Fellowship, and the NSW Premier's Prize for Excellence in Medical Biological Science in 2015. He is a Fellow of the Australian Academy of Science, the Academy of Social Sciences in Australia, and a corresponding member of the Academy of Athens. His novel, In His Image, Katikona, was published in Greece in 2015, and now we're planning to present it in Corfu. It is my pleasure to give you the chair.
Ευχαριστώ, Τάκη. Πάντα αισθάνομαι ντροπή όταν με παρουσιάζουν, είπε ο Μαρκ Τουέιν. Ποτέ δεν λένε αρκετά. Colleagues from outside, Mark Twain said, I always feel embarrassed when they introduce me. They never say enough. Brain behavior and evolution. The first atlas that Takis mentioned was published in 1982, many years ago. And it happened that a number of people did their PhDs using that screen directory for the brain. And recently I met a woman at a neuroscience meeting, and she said, George Paxinos, I thought you were dead. Another time I was giving a talk in Munich, Germany, and one girl asked another, do you know, have you seen Paxinos? And she said, yes, it is on my shelf. Καθώς βλέπετε, έχω ένα πρόβλημα με την εικόνα μου. First, I want to thank the Australian government for being so generous to neuroscience. This is my laboratory.
Very fascinating.
Για λεπού, βγήκε στο σπίτι ενός ειδοποιού και ανασύγοντας τα πράγματα, βρήκε μία μάσκα, μία υπέροχη απομίμηση ενός ανθρωπίνου κεφαλιού. Έβαλε το πόδι της επάνω του και είπε «Τι όμορφο κεφάλι, εν τούτης δεν έχει καμία αξία, γιατί είναι εντελώς χωρίς μυαλό». Και αυτή την αγάπη για τον εγκέφαλο που εξέφρασε ο Έσοπος θα τη δείτε και στις εργασίες άλλων ανθρώπων της τέχνης, όπως εδώ ο George Bernard Shaw. Δεν θα συμφωνούσες μαζί μου ότι είναι αδιανόητο, μια και η ζωή έφτιαξε τα πουλιά. Εάν η αγάπη και η ομορφιά και το αντικείμενό τους θα άρχιζε μια άλλη γραμμή και θα δούλευε για να δημιουργήσει τον ακαμπάτικο ελέφαντα και τον άσχημο χυματζή του, ο οποίος εμείς είμαστε οι απόγονοι. Ο διάβολος τότε συμπεραίνει ότι η ζωή είχε σκοπό την ατσαλοσύνη και την ασκημιά. Ο Ντον Χουάν, όχι διαβολεμένε διάβολε που είσαι, χίλιες φορές όχι. Η ζωή είχε σκοπό τον εγκέφαλο, το αγαπημένο της όργανο, ένα όργανο με τον οποίο μπορεί να αποκτήσει κατανόηση του εαυτού της. Και αυτή την αγάπη για τον εγκέφαλο, και εγώ θα πει το τέλος της ομιλίας, θα σας πω ορισμένα άσχημα πράγματα για τον εγκέφαλο, αλλά να αρχίσω με αυτά, τη βλέπετε διάχυτη και σε άλλους αρτίστες. Ποιος θα θεωρούσε τον Woody Allen σαν οπτιμιστή? Εν τούτης, ακόμα κι αυτός, όταν έχει να πει κάτι για τον εγκέφαλο, κάτι θετικό λέει. Λέει, ο εγκέφαλος είναι το δεύτερο πιο αγαπητό μου όργανο. Από το μύθο στην ευρωεπιστήμη, χωρίς ιδιαίτερο λόγη. Is it alright that I speak, when it's in English, I can speak in Greek? It's okay, Μετάκη? Χωρίς να ιδιαίτερο έλεγχο, δεν είναι δυνατόν να βρει κανείς ότι ο εγκέφαλος είναι αυτός που δημιουργεί το νου. Και ο πρώτος, δείτε ότι οι Αιγύπτιοι απερίσκεπτα επέταγαν τον εγκέφαλο και έστειλαν για χιλιετερίες φαραώ ανεγκέφαλος στη μεταθάνατο ζωή. Ορισμένοι προσοκρατικοί φιλόσοφοι απέρριψαν οι μεταφυσικές λόγους και μυθικές εξηγήσεις για το φυσικό κόσμο και για την φύση της, αν θέλετε, της ψυχής, του νου. Και αυτοί οι φιλόσοφοι απέρριψαν τον μύθο και τον αντικατέστησαν με την πραγματικότητα και απέρριψαν θεούς και μαγεία. Ορισμένοι θεωρούν ότι ο Αλκμαίων, που έζησε περί το 500 π.Χ., πιθανώς να ήταν μαθητής του Πυθαγόρα, στο Κρότον, στη Μάνια Γκρέτσια, στη Μεγάλη Ελλάδα, ήταν ο πρώτος που ανακάλυψε τη σχέση μεταξύ του εγκεφάλου και του νου. Το Κρότον είναι το Κροτόνι της σημερινής Ιταλίας, βλέπετε εδώ, στη μπότα της Ιταλίας, και στο σημερινό Κροτόνι. Η σκέψη αυτή του Αλκμαίωνα φαίνεται ότι πέρασε στην Γκο, που ήταν ο μεγαλύτερος ιατρός της αρχαιότητας, ο Ιπποκράτης. Εδώ είναι η Κος, και ο Ιπποκράτης είπε κάτι τρομακτικά έξυπνο. Οι ανθρώποι πρέπει να γνωρίζουν ότι από τον εγκέφαλο και μόνο από τον εγκέφαλο πηγάζουν η ευχαρίστησή μας, το γέλιο μας, οι κινήσεις μας, οι θλίψεις μας, ο πόνος και τα δάκρυα. Αυτό μπορεί να διδαχθεί σε οποιοδήποτε τμήμα νευροεπιστήμη σήμερα. Και ο εγκέφαλος διατήρησε μία κάπως καλή κατάσταση με τον Πλάτωνα, αλλά τα μπέρδεψε λίγο ο Πλάτωνας. Θεώρησε ότι υπάρχουν τρεις ψυχές. Διατήρησε την rational, την διανοητική ψυχή στον εγκέφαλο. Τον αδύρου του εγκεφάλου φτάνει με τον Αριστοτέλη, που αναφέρεται ότι ο εγκέφαλος είναι εκεί για να κρυώνει το αίμα, δηλαδή είναι for air conditioning. Και να σκεφτείτε ότι η καρδιοκεντρική θεωρία, η καρδιά έχει θέσει το την έδρα της ψυχής, το Αριστοτέλη, και διατηρήθηκε για παραπάνω από 1000 χρόνια, από 1500 χρόνια, και λένε ότι professors greatness, η αξία ενός καθηγητή μετριέται με το πόσο χρόνια κατάφερε να εμποδίσει πρόοδο στον τομέα του. Ο Αριστοτέλης, ο μεγαλύτερος επιστήμον της αρχαιότητος, εν τούτης αστόχησε σε αυτό και καθυστέρησε την πρόοδο στον τομέα, αλλά και ένας άλλος, ο Γαλινός από την Πέραμο, ο οποίος περιέγραψε την σκέψη του Αριστοτέλη σαν παράλογη και η καρδιοκεντρική θέση του Αριστοτέλη και η εγκεφαλικοκεντρική θέση του Γαλινού ανταγωνιζόταν η μία την άλλη μέχρι την αυγή της μοντέρνας επιστήμης και στον έμπορο της Βενετίας του Σέξπιρ η Πόρσια ρωτάει «Πες μου, πού εδρεύει η αγάπη ή στην καρδιά ή στο μυαλό» και για χιλιάδες χρόνια αυτό ήταν πρόβλημα. Η κατάληξη σήμερα είναι ότι ανησύχησα, ξέρετε εγώ, αξίδα την English, not because I don't have the Greek, the English version. I was troubled when on a Valentine's Day I went to the card shop and I found they had about 300 Valentine cards, but in all of them with a heart, at least one, certainly one red heart in each one of them. None of them had a brain on them. So I wrote it here, the brain will be as beautiful as the heart, and far more importantly, it is true that it is in the brain that love resides. The cardiac transplant surgeons did a disservice to their profession when they show in heart transplants that the recipient does not fall in love with the wife of the dead man. And I wrote a letter to the newspaper on Valentine's Day. And after so much effort to localize where the psyche resides, things that are thought to be in the psyche, such as love, psychology lost the psyche in the 1930s. And I show you here a photo of him. Sophia is from McGill, and he was a chancellor at McGill. He was expert. He incidentally discovered how brainwashing works, right? And I remember the student newspaper at McGill when he became chancellor. Expert in brainwashing becomes chancellor of our university. I thought it was a good title for the newspaper article. Hebb considers the mind to be the integration of the activity of the brain. And the philosophers, such as Patricia Churchland, said there's no ghost in the machine, there's no ghost inside us. And of course, we have evidence from Alzheimer's case and others that it is the brain and brain alone that matters. If the brain sustains damage, conventional damage occurs to behavior. So in other words, there was many neuroscientists consider this, they might be incorrect, and there might be a soul, and we don't know that. But at the moment, you don't need to hypothesize the presence of a soul to study and modify human behavior. Psychologists do not speak about the soul. There might be one, but there's no need for it. It is superfluous to requirements, surplus to requirements. And I just wrote an article in a newspaper in Sydney, why psychology lost its soul. Everything comes from the brain. And the next thing, so many neuroscience philosophers, not everybody, in the end, the minority will be correct. In science, you don't establish truth by consensus. But anyway, a lot of neuroscientists think that we can understand behavior without invoking the presence of the soul. And I hope you have some questions on that, and I'll be happy to present some data that supports that. The question is whether there is free will, because this has significant implications of how we treat people. And B.F. Skinner, I had the luck to meet him. I invited him to give a talk at McGill, a very interesting character. And he thinks that behavior is the result of two factors, the genetic endowment and the environmental influences on that genetic endowment that sculpted, that molded. We have no option on either. We cannot choose our parents, and we are born here not because of our free will, decision to be born in Greece or in Iran or in Afghanistan. And I see a lot of men here. If we are all men who are born in Afghanistan, my suspicion is that most of us would go and stone a woman who allegedly burned the Quran. Here, if we heard here that a woman burned the Bible, we wouldn't, most of us, we would not, virtually nobody would go and stone her. So the environment is what makes you, together with the genetic endowment that you have. And there's a nice phrase on that in a poem by Lord Denison, Ulysses. I am what I have met. Again, I am what I have met. I think that summarizes it. Now, something about brains and some the work that I have been doing in this area. We started work on the brain of the rat because most psychologists work on experimental animals and principally the rat. And there are many things that you can find from the rat, and some of them are applicable to humans. And we did an atlas that was stereotaxic, that is, you could give the coordinates of brain structures. And the aim of my research has been to assist scientists to navigate seamlessly between the brain of humans and experimental animals, to test hypotheses inspired by human considerations, such as to construct an animal model of Parkinson's, of Alzheimer's disease, of epilepsy, of schizophrenia, of depression, and then relate their observations back to the human. And for this reason, I've constructed atlases of the brains of experimental animals and of humans, and used the same nomenclature, the same names, for equivalent structures, homologous structures across the species, so that there's no impediment in transferring the information across from one animal to the other. How does the brain differ from other organs? Rakesh said that it has a map of our body, it has a map of the outside world, it has a map of our experience. It's the only organ that has that. Some statistics about the brain: 1,000 nuclei, 2,000 major connections, 200 major neurotransmitters, 200 major enzymes, 20,000 genes are expressed in the brain. Which brain is that? Well, any mammalian brain, and I would hope you would agree with me before the end of my talk, that any avian, any bird brain as well, and tell a difference. Well, the difference is that the human brain has 100 billion neurons, and that's a lot of neurons compared to the size of a mammal we are, and even the size of the brain we have. To consider, the whale has a 10 kilo brain, the sperm whale, the largest brain around. And yet, we might have more neurons than the whale because of we possess primate neurons, which are different. They are smaller, but as a consequence, you can fit a lot more in the brain, and maybe the computer scientists will be able to tell us something about that. There seems to be some advantage in having a hell of a lot more processing units, though they are smaller. We are not going to be threatened by a rat, for the rat, knowing the neurons it has, to have the same number of neurons as us, we have to have a brain the size of this table. It's not going to threaten us, the rat. Now, the human family, we have here humans, the chimpanzees, something 5 million years removed. The monkeys, something like 11 million years removed from us. The rodents, 40 million years removed from us. The birds, somewhere near Kithira, 400 million years removed from us. They're different, and yet, in many ways, the brain is conserved, hasn't changed all that much. Is it clear what I say that the distance, how different we are, is determined by how long we haven't reproduced one with the other? I'll just give you a simple example. The Greeks from Greece and the Greeks from Cyprus are pretty close to each other genetically. That is the phenotype. You look at them, they look similar, but the Cypriots seem to be a bit darker. Darker eyes, darker hair, on the average, slightly. The Greeks and the Norwegians, well, there you can actually see a difference. They tend to be blonde, blue-eyed, far more than the Greeks here. That's because the Greeks from Cyprus and us, the Greeks from Greece, separated maybe a couple thousand years ago. In Sweden and in Greece, the separation, no genes were exchanged for maybe 8,000 years. The Europeans and the Chinese have not been exchanging genes maybe for 20,000 years. And you can see that the differences are greater. The Europeans and the Aborigines have not exchanged genes for perhaps 100,000 years. The differences are greater. We don't know whom they favor in these differences. That's, everybody is evolving, right? The humans and the chimpanzees had a common ancestor, something like 5 million years ago, alright? There was just one ancestor. The chimpanzees are not our ancestors, neither we, the ancestors of the chimpanzees. We're cousins, much like we and the Norwegians, alright? And that's how the distance between species is considered. But no sooner did we make some progress on the rat brain that we lost our confidence that the human the confidence that the rat brain was the final frontier. And we started studying the human brain, which you can see the rat brain can fit in one of the sulci. And in both the human and the rat, we studied the brain using different stains. What my laboratory added to this study of the nervous system and the brain and the spinal cord is that we used chemical stains to see the organization of the brain, and we were able to also jump from one species to the next. See, for example, here in the amygdala, there is one very dense staining structure. It's called the basal lateral nucleus. And if you look at the rat, if you go to the monkey, there's also one very dense staining structure in the amygdala. And scientists argue that must be the homologue, the corresponding structure in the primate amygdala, in the monkey amygdala, the basal lateral nucleus. So we use this as a Rosetta Stone to study, to transfer the information, and you can see here the Rosetta Stone as in hieroglyphic and in Greek, the same story was told, and then you can decipher what things were. And Floyd Bloom said the gain in the brain is mainly in the stain. And we use the same principle of looking at different stains in the avian brain, the chick brain. And you might say, chick brain, why would you ever study a chick brain? Every language you look at, there is something nasty said about the bird brain. Well, we think that birds have first-class brains. They just haven't had good public relations. And we studied the chick brain, and we found the correspondences. It's easier to work in embryology on the chip plate, because the embryo is given to you. You don't have to anesthetize the dam to cut her, take the embryo out, try to put it back in and stitch the female. None of that. It's there in the egg. You make a little hole, you make your intervention, you take a bit of sticky tape, you put it over the egg, and then you take the next egg. So a lot of good work has been done in developmental neuroscience using birds, and constructed an atlas so we can assist the neuroscientists who study that species. And our working assumption is that the bird did not fly in from Mars. The birds are the descendants of the dinosaurs. So next time you see a cotoculo, say bonjour to a dinosaur. They are dinosaurs, right? And there's one strain of dinosaurs that survived. That's them, the birds. Of course, a lot of people are interested in the mouse because of the availability of transgenic varieties. And we studied the mouse and considered the continuity in biology. The same genes that are responsible for the patterning, for the segmentation of the Drosophila body, whether something will develop a leg or a wing, are also responsible to in the mouse whether the segment is going to develop a leg or it will develop, it will have give the origin to a nerve. It's the genes, the Hox genes, as they call them, and we studied them to see how the brain is organized. I will not trouble you much with deep anatomy, but there is a different organization you can see if you examine how the genes are distributed in the embryo or in the adult in transgenic mice. And it gives us a handle on how the brain is organized. It's very difficult to decide where to put what in the brain. The brain has about 1,000 parts. But what are the superordinate structures? That is, what belongs to the rhombomere, to the isthmus, to the mesencephalon, to the diencephalon, to the telencephalon? And within it, what belongs to the different subsectors? Well, this can be helped with development. So we studied the bird initially because that's where the information was in development, and then we studied this from an atlas of the bird brain that we did. We studied the mammal in the same way now with the availability of transgenic varieties. In giving names to areas, it is not correct to call an area, you and me, we agree that we call it ventral. It's not correct, because if it's not ventral in development, then you're committing an error, because you're telling the students that this area has been subjected to ventralizing influences in development. And it hasn't been, if it's not ventral in development. So, unlike literature, where Shakespeare said, a rose, under any other name, smells as sweet. Well, it's not so in neuroanatomy, and we initially did these atlases of the brain, histological atlas of the brain, using stains to stain the tissue, but now we are looking at the images. What you're seeing here is a magnetic MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, and you can see the brain as though it's histology in some ways. And you can see here, for example, the hippocampus where memory is required for memory consolidation. And it's not from the beginning. Let me see what take it down here. Yeah. And further along, you see here the substantia nigra, where if neurons are lost, you develop Parkinson's disease if the neurons are lost here. So this doesn't have to be postmortem. It could be the living organism. In this particular case, it wasn't, but it can be the living organism because you can study like that through imaging. Yeah, many of you might have had images. Here, that was a mouse. This is the rat. And we published this book, we published last year. where you can see the fiber tracts in the rat brain in different color, depending on what orientation they have. This is the benefit of the DTI, diffusion tensor imaging. And this is collaboration with the people at Duke University, and we were able to do an atlas that's based only on these images. You can see this image here, and you can see that this missile, this conventional histology, the tissue is taken and passed in different baths and stained. Here, this is imaging. This is just in the magnet, MRI. And you can see some structures here quite well, but here it was difficult. But we eventually managed to find these things here, to find signals for them here. I don't know if you can see here, this is darker than from here to here. This is lighter here, this is darker, and it becomes lighter in here. And the darkness here corresponds with this area here, which we know is the representation of the whiskers of the mustachial vibrissae of the rat. So once we discover an area like that here, that this corresponds to that, then look what happens. You know where Switzerland is. Immediately you know where Germany, Italy, Austria, and France are. So immediately we can identify another four areas. And this is the way we worked, and we did this atlas here, that you can see the diagrams of the rat brain based only on images, and we published it last year. Now, no mouse is an island. And a lot of people want to study the human brain. There has been someone who studied the human brain quite well. Von Economo, the same guy who discovered the encephalitic lethargica. He and Koskinas established the best atlas. Koskinas returned to this. Economo was given a medal by the Academy of Athens. He was offered the chair of psychiatry and neurology at the University, Kapodistrian University of Athens, but he never came back. And he made this atlas, amazing work, and nobody has surpassed him. We have used some of his delineations in our work with the non-human primates, with the rhesus monkey and the marmoset. But firstly, I want to tell you that before trying our hands on the human, we thought of firstly trying to do an atlas of another primate. I want to be able to examine the chimpanzee. I didn't have a chimpanzee pose for me, so I'm showing you a photo of an orangutan. You can see how similar they are externally to us. Internally, the brain is likewise very similar. It isn't very easy to find a chimpanzee brain. I wrote to the Taronga Park Zoo in Sydney requesting the opportunity to do a post-mortem on the chimpanzee brain once the chimpanzee died. They responded that they would be happy to oblige, but they hadn't had a death of a chimpanzee in the zoo for a decade. 2 months after receiving my letter, 3 chimpanzees died. Luckily, they didn't suspect me. I studied the brain of one of them and didn't find any differences in the brain stem that I looked at with the brain of the humans. Now, we used the work of Von Economo and Koskinas in our work on the marmoset brain that you can see here. It's a small primate, the size of a small size rat, but it has a primate brain in it, not a rodent brain, primate. And it's about 50% larger than the rat brain, though it's like a small rat in size. Okay? So it has a primate brain. And we find actually just about the same areas that you find in the rhesus monkey in the marmoset. And the rhesus monkey has 1-to-1 for most areas of the cortex with the human, and they correspond. For the human brain, we have done some work on the subcortex with some satisfactory results, but for the cortex of the human, we are not happy yet that we haven't done the work well enough in the cortex. I show you here that most people who work with MRI and test humans for experimental purposes are interested in the cortex. And this individual here is alive and well. And oops, and what happened? The person's viewing, moving the dots here that are moving. And you can see that there's activation in the principal part of the visual areas, but here too, in the kithera, right? A small area. And people who work with MRI ask us, what is that area? And we scratch our heads because we don't know. We open Brodmann and he doesn't describe that area. So there's a need for a more accurate atlas and more comprehensive atlas of the human cortex, and some scientists have started that work already. And you can see here from Petridis and Pandya the areas of the prefrontal cortex of the human and the areas of the prefrontal cortex of the rhesus monkey, and they correspond one to one, even in the areas which you would have thought would have been different, because humans have a capacity to speak. 45A, 45B, these areas are involved in speech. They're Broca's area, right? And when we were producing an atlas with these researchers, we had an objection. Another scientist objected, said, well, when did you last have a conversation with a monkey? Don't you know that these areas, 45A and 45B, are Broca's areas? And our response to that objection was, that was why discover in the rhesus monkey an area that you know for sure is involved in speech in human. The monkey doesn't talk to you. And our response to that was that we are going to establish the homology and call it the same name, much like on the same principle that this part, this hemisphere, has an area 45A and 45B, though it does not speak. It is this hemisphere that has speech area associated with area 45A and 45B. So if we had the right to name this area here the same as here, though they do different functions, we have the right to name in the rhesus monkey the area that has similar cytoarchitecture, chemoarchitecture, and connectivity with the same name. And this is what we have done. We have used the same name. Now, the subordination of structures, as I mentioned earlier, is we did this on the basis of development. And really, the driver of this was Luis Huelles from Spain. And on the basis of how the thing develops, that's where you put a derivative a specification of the different structures, the subdivisions afterwards. And we produced a nomenclature, an ontology that places all the structures of the brain under a tree where things belong. And we at the same time dispensed with the names for the alien literature. The names were many times homologous, sorry, they were, the homologous structures were given different names in the bird than in the mammal. And we said that we had to dispense with the alien names, use only the mammalian names on the principle that it's the dog that wags the tail and not the tail of the dog. And most scientists work on the mammal. Few who work on the bird have to adjust so that we have the same nomenclature for the same, that is, homologous structures. And we thought that we would be really carried out on the shoulders of people when we gave them the alien workers, we gave them this new avenue of communicating with the rest of the neuroscience community by using the same names and getting rid of variants. But somebody said neuroscientists could rather swap toothbrushes than nomenclature. They don't like you to change the names that they're familiar with. So there are people who don't like me, many people who don't like me now, but in the process of doing this, when we were optimistic still that we would be well received by the Asian workers, we commissioned a symphony to go together with the publication of the Atlas of the Alien Brain, of the Chick Brain, a symphony that took in the... Is the sound available? Took in some of the flavor of the country in which the project was planned, that is France, under the direction of Nicole Duran, and where it was executed, in España, under the direction of Luis Puelles. Now, I mentioned that I would say some things about the brain that are not as kind as some of the other people have said, especially the artists. The brain, no other organ since Narcissus fell in love with the reflection of his face on the surface of the river, has been so adored as now the brain, and never with enough justification. And to understand what we really are, know thyself. Well, it was E.O. Wilson who said, puzzled we stand before nature. We don't know why we're here. We have Paleolithic emotions and a technology that threatens our existence and that of the other living creatures. And I would like to add, just in case this isn't enough burden, that likely without the soul, without free will, and with a 1,300 gram brain made in part from reptilian leftovers, and we have the problem. We don't know ourselves. That's what we are. We don't know ourselves, and we have the hubris. And here you have Phaethon taking control of the rays of the sun, and Zeus striking him down before causing huge problem. And of course, the problem we cause now is the change of the chemistry of the atmosphere, one of the problems, many others. And if the brain is not responsible for that, then I don't know what it is. And the question I'd like to ask, again, if the brain is the right size to say no to the CO2 sarcophagus that the fossil fuel industry is placing on our heads, I don't think so. I don't think it's capable. And then is the brain the right size? And if the brain was smaller than what it is, incapable of supporting language, which is responsible for the development of science and technology, which today threaten existence, it would not be a problem. If the brain was larger than what it is, then αν το εγκέφαλο ήταν μεγαλύτερο από ό,τι είναι, πιθανώ είμαστε ικανοί να αντιληφθούμε το πρόβλημα και πιθανώ ακόμα και να το λύσουμε. Και η κατάληξή μου, κύριε Βλάμο, είναι ότι ο εγκέφαλο δεν έχει το κατάλληλο μέγεθο. Σα ευχαριστώ. Yeah, we have. I wasn't provocative enough here. Yes, please.
We appreciate your presentation. However,
Thanks to my name. Professor, I appreciate your presentation, and I am puzzled with the issue of the brain and the nous you mentioned before. So we know that we only one structure that we have that and use that, and we make miracles throughout all the ages. And that has to do, we mentioned before, we are what we meet, what we met. Είμαστε ότι ζούμε. But who made what we live? Human being. So actually, we are what other human beings create for us. So actually, we are what we are.
That's poetic and philosophical at the same time. Yes, we are what we are, and we have no freedom to change anything anymore than the brain can be changed, of course. Psychologists make a living out of modifying behavior, but it's not you that you can decide, well, she left me, I don't love her anymore, I love this one who wants me. We have no freedom. I'll give you an example. That in emotion, such as love, there's enough in the literature, and you might have experienced yourself or seen it in others, that they tell you, I want to lose my love for this person. I just can't. If there's ever an indication in behavior that the person actually cannot do it, it is this. They tell you that I don't want to love them anymore. Sometimes they commit suicide because they have been rebuffed in the love. And the other thing, I mean, if you understand, I mean, this is not idle talk about freedom for love, because as you might know, that more than 50% of the people who are dropped, they parenochlun, they trouble the partner who dropped them in their house, in their work, in the internet. Some of them hit them, some of them kill them. But if only they understood that the person who dropped them and they have no more love for them cannot reacquire the love that they lost anymore, that they themselves can stop loving them. In other words, love happens or it doesn't happen. There's no freedom. I mean, of course, these are indications, and somebody can argue otherwise. And of course, time can do many things. In behavior, they were not slaves of yesterday, and can be conditioned otherwise. But certainly what is evident is that love cannot be transferred from one person to the next at your will. It can happen, but it's not at your will. So I brought you one indication that there's no freedom.
Excuse me, but this is the time for debates since last night, and I don't want to debate, but I will beg the difference with you that we are totally free, and when I change my mind to love something else, something made me to do that, and my freedom direct me to drop the yesterdays and love the todays. And I don't want to misunderstand the word love, which in the English language is very poor, and I put it in the Greek word, is pothos. It's a different thing to pothis something, and it's a different thing to love something. Allo agapi, allo pothos. Thank you.
So I very much enjoyed your talk. So as if free will and soul were not difficult enough questions, I'm going to ask you whether you have a position about the neural correlates of consciousness. Well, it must be easier to figure this out, and yet we haven't even come up with a definition of consciousness and the neural correlates of.
Yeah, that's right. There is a good definition, but as a description, Susan Greenfield said that it's something that you have more of when you are attentive and you are in the middle of the day, less of when you are falling asleep at night, less of when you are an embryo, less of when you are dementing. Okay, if we go with that, the only thing I can say about consciousness is that it is not something that resides in the soul. This is, and I can tell you,
or the
evidence. Sorry?
Or the gut.
Or the gut. Right.
Or the heart.
Or the heart, that's right. The only evidence that I can bring to that is the one from the split brain preparations. In fact, it was Descartes who made the argument that the brain is divisible. You can take the brain, cut it in half, cut it in four pieces, as many pieces as you want. It's divisible. But the soul, you can't cut it. It's indivisible. Well, consciousness, if you like, consciousness is actually divisible. Guess what? When Sperry made the split brain preparations to alleviate epilepsy spread from one to the other, hemisphere, and now these patients were given under only experimental conditions, of course, by Gazzariga and others, they were given stimuli only to this hemisphere or only to this. And depending on which hemisphere they tested, they got different responses to the same stimulus. In other words, two different conditionings occurred in the two different hemispheres, two different consciousness, if you like, occurred. That even might be my...
Any?
Yeah, a comment, and then a question. Excellent work. I enjoyed very much your talk. But if we believe that we don't have free will, which we don't have the evidence yet, okay, otherwise, we would be living in a deterministic universe. So we would be like actors in a divine or a natural play, theatrical play. So whatever you say or whatever I say, somebody else, nature, God, whatever, makes us do. So we would not be able to either say that somebody is bad, like Hitler or Trump, or somebody is good.
Excuse me?
Okay. or somebody is good. So we would all be theatrical players. But there are a lot of evidence that from psychologists, mainly in the US and in Canada, that have found out that, first of all, belief in free will is found in almost every society, in Asian societies, American, South American, European, over 70-75% of people believing in free will, first of all. And second, the people who believe in free will have the tendency to enjoy their life better and have a better life and better careers. So believing that you can succeed in something and you can change your life is by itself a good thing. You could argue that this is probably a genetic thing or an environmental thing, but it's not environmental because it's in almost every human society. And until we know what the conscience is, we will not be able to have experiments to decide there is a free will or not. And I come to my question. There are some publications, two publications about a couple of patients with epilepsy that had site-specific epilepsy in colostrum. And when they had this epileptic seizure, they lost conscience. And they had their eyes open, but they couldn't understand any they couldn't see, they couldn't hear, they couldn't smell, they couldn't feel pain, whatever. So maybe we're getting closer to what conscience is. And I wanted to ask you, what is the role of the claustrum? What is its function? Do you know?
Yeah, it's well, in the birds we couldn't find it. Or alternatively, the pallium of the bird is a blown out claustrum. That's also possible. So maybe that's more likely. They thought the marsupials in Australia didn't have claustrum. They published on that. And we published a paper, here is the claustrum of the marsupials. So it's there. I'm not sure what it does, but certainly it is there. It's getting a number of connections from the amygdala. So presumably you have something to do with what the affiliations, the connections that it has. But as it concerns the what happens to you if you accept that you have no freedom, you have no free will, but you are just a product of your genes and your environment. Just consider what Jesus Christ said. He was a good philosopher. He said, "Ugar ida sitipiusi." They don't know what they are doing. What does that mean? That if they knew what we know, they would be with us. Now they are crucifying me. He forgave them because they are not responsible for what they are doing. And you can lose your hatred if you accept that position. One of the reasons that I wrote a novel, and I made a mistake, because it took me 16 years to write it. I didn't know that it was going to be so hard. They say that science is 90% perspiration, 10% inspiration. Well, literature is worse. One of the heroes gives the example of the rocks in the seashore. You do not blame the sharp rocks that were the weather, it's sharp, and you can't put your foot on them, it's lacerating your foot. And you don't praise the smooth rocks. There's no blame and there's no praise. We are the products of our environment. And this has significant implications about the legal system. You still can go and incarcerate someone who killed your brother, goes to jail, because if you leave him out, you might kill another one. Also, it becomes an example to me. If I wanted to kill you, then I say, oh, well, I go to jail too. So that's all right for the legal system to do that. But it's not correct to punish people, because people are what they are. Whoever you mention, I'm telling you, the men, you and me, if we were born in Afghanistan and we heard about this lady burning the Quran, most likely will do like the other Afghan men and go and stone her, you and me.
Yeah, but okay, this is a position of the Stoics, the Stoic philosophers in ancient Greece, that they were very deterministic. But there was another Greek philosopher, Epicurus, who believed in free will, and he believed that the study of nature and science could enlighten people. And when people, Galileo and others, Locke, discovered again the Epicurean writings, the Renaissance and the Enlightenment years came. So we need science in order to make a better world. And if we don't believe that this is by free will, that we decide to use our knowledge for the good, I don't think it's fate. Otherwise, you would say that the Middle Ages, the thousand years that science was expelled, was natural. And the scientific world now is natural as well. And the disaster after all this chaos will be natural as well. I think it's good to believe in free will and believe that we have the right to decide according to our values. Otherwise,
the society will not be a harder society if you accept the position that there's no freedom whatsoever. That is, if you consider, in fact, you can be a gentle person that way, consider the age, the military age Greek boys here, 20, 22. I had a cousin who told me that 22 people were in the company he was in. Every one of them is a smoker. Now, in Australia, only 13% of the people there are smokers. Are you saying that the Greeks decided out of their free will to smoke? Or the Afghans decided out of their free will to stone that lady? It's a far gentler explanation to consider that the environment conditions you and gives you an opportunity to change the environment, to change the conditions, to produce a person who is not either suffering from these addictions or goes and stones people. It is what your behavior is determined by other things, but you are not predetermined in the sense that forever you go, and the environmental stimulus can come along and you can change. Psychologists can talk to you, a priest can talk to you and change you.
Professor, thank you. A related question, if I may. If we are adapt,
if we adapt this notion that there's no free will, then it's impossible.
Yes,
then it's no. I don't want to debate with you. That was yesterday. If it was not a free will, how it's possible the human race to have that tremendous progress since antiquity to today?
If I don't have free will, it doesn't mean that I will not take in the environment. We have a bigger brain than other animals, and that is likely the reason for our success. Also, more effective neurons are primates than non-primates, who might have far bigger brain than us, such as the elephant, four times bigger than us. So that doesn't prevent you from learning, but you are what we are all subjected to is environments, which will influence you this way or that way. And the brain is in a civil war, ideas there, it's like the Greek parliament here, that they're fighting. That is, which idea will, when you are thinking about, should I be married with this person, remain married, marry this person? This is what's happening. Some parts are conditioned because of certain stimuli. Every stimulus environment is conditioned stimulus. Nothing is neutral. Because of your experiences in life. So if you accept that, you can understand and forgive people who are not so nice to you. And you say, well, that's what happens. And you can forgive ISIS. ISIS was born out of what? If you look back, and you can understand these people too.
I think that you have a lot of to discuss tonight, after dinner or during dinner. Thank you, Professor Baxinos. Dear guests, honored participants, distinguished professors, Mr. Minister, on behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to warmly welcome you to Sparta for the second Congress, World Congress GeNeDis. We are delighted to have you here in Sparta to share your experience and to contribute to the research in the field of genetics, geriatrics, and neurodegenerative diseases. This event is designed for promoting science and development and accelerating international scientific information exchange. The fact that so many of you are here today reflects a mutual recognition of the importance to work together in an interdisciplinary way. So, once more, on behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to thank you all very much for coming. It now gives me great pleasure to hand over to Professor Panayotis Vlamos to add his words to welcome to you all.
should see the slides.
So, honored guests and participants, dear Minister of Health, dear Prefect of Laconia, dear Prefect of Ionian Islands, dear Mayor of Sparta, dear organizers, supporters, and attendees, I would like to welcome you to the Second World Congress on Genetics, Geriatrics, and Neurodegenerative Diseases that is held here in Sparta, one of the most important Greek city states throughout the archaic and classical period. So, let us see. I'm not to bother you with a lot of things. As Mrs. Michopoulou said, it is almost the definition of what we call in science interdisciplinary. A lot of sciences coming together. If you see persons, the persons that are involved here, you see excellent scientists from different topics, and we expect all of them to come together as they have come and accept our invitation with a very eager way and discuss scientifically together. So one of the major things that we have seen is what are we dealing with? The future, we believe, it's concerned four different things. One is the ending omics, proteomics, genomics, etc. The second is what we have, what we can achieve with computational tools. These computational tools are not just a way that bioinformatics should work, but they should be a very useful tool in the hands of the doctor. The doctors are the end users of all this work, and we just a black box inside their work with the patients. So what will give us as the future will be precision medicine. Precision medicine is what we hope to achieve in the next two decades. This will end up to stop with statistics and deal with each person exactly according to its biomarkers and its clinical data. You will see a lot of work done here by our guests, and you will have the opportunity just now to hear Professor Giannakopoulos talking about personalized biomarkers. The goal of the whole conference of GeNeDis is just one. We don't want to promote anything, but we just want to have all these persons involved here from different aspects of science to just sit and talk together. And also, we have tried that everyone will say, especially the keynote and invited speakers, unpublished work that is going on in our days. So we hope to have at each GeNeDis a glance in the future of the research in the next decade. Let's talk about the numbers. We have 9 co-organizers, 68 program committee members, I don't remember exactly the numbers, 33 persons that work with the organizing committee, 21 keynote with invited speakers, 90 papers throughout the program selected from more than 140 papers, which all of them, most of them were excellent. We hope to have more days in our program also. 3 workshops, 4 special sessions, 12 social events, 8 sponsors, 11 auspices. Also, we have done 3 satellite events to promote the Congress until this day, and 7 media sponsors. Our invited speakers are from various countries, USA, Jordan, United Kingdom, Canada, Italy, Switzerland, Israel, Australia. We have seen about the papers, registration, we have also I gathered some countries which were very interesting, Peru, India, Nigeria, Iran, Iraq, Abu Dhabi, Jeddah, etc. We have up to now more than 500 registrations accepted. We expect most of the people that are coming, especially for the second day that all the lectures are beginning. You can see the auspices, yes, and you can see also the organizers. So What I would like mainly to say is that we do hope that all of you will enjoy the conference. This is our main goal. We do hope that all of you will discuss scientifically in and out of the lectures. And finally, what we would like to say is a great thanks for the local organizer, for the professor of Peloponnese, for the mayor of Sparta, for the university of Peloponnese that helped us enormously, and for all the people that have worked. And a special thanks for the Minister of Health that changed his program for coming here. We are obliged to him. I hope you will enjoy the conference.
And now I would like to ask the Minister of Health, Andreas Santos, to come to bring his message to the Congress.
Αξιότιμοι διοργανωτές, αξιότιμοι εκπρόσωποι της τοπικής αυτοδιοίκησης Πανεπιστημίου, αξιότιμοι προσκεκλημένοι του συνεδρίου, θα με συγχωρήσετε για την αναγκαστικά ομιλία μου στα ελληνικά. Είμαι ιδιαίτερα περήφανος που είμαι σήμερα σε αυτό το συνέδριο. Νομίζω ότι είναι τιμή για τους εκπροσώπους της πολιτείας να παρευρίσκονται σε επιστημονικές συναντήσεις αυτού του επίπεδου. Θεωρώ ότι είναι τιμητικό για τον επιστημονικό κόσμο της χώρας, είναι τιμητικό για το Ιόνιο Πανεπιστήμιο και για όσους συνδράμουν και συνέδραμαν σε αυτή την οργάνωση που θεωρώ ότι συζητά ζητήματα που απασχολούν πλέον την παγκόσμια κοινότητα, την παγκόσμια επιστημονική κοινότητα και την ερευνητική κοινότητα. Είναι επίσης πολύ ενθαρρυντικό το ότι σε μια περίοδο που η χώρα μας εξακολουθεί να έχει σοβαρά οικονομικά και κοινωνικά προβλήματα, υπάρχουν ισχυρές αιστείες επιστημονικής έρευνας, καινοτομίας, αναζήτησης νέων θεραπειών, αναζήτησης νέων τεχνικών και κυρίως προσπάθειας η έρευνα να έχει κοινωνική ανταποδοτικότητα, να μπορεί να εφαρμόζεται και να συμβάλλει στη βελτίωση της ποιότητας ζωής των πολιτών. Η παγκόσμια επιστημονική κοινότητα, το ερευνητικό δυναμικό σε όλες τις χώρες του κόσμου, οι μεγάλες εταιρείες παράγουν συνεχώς καινούργια καινοτόμα προϊόντα, φαρμακευτικά και ιατροτεχνολογικά, και υπάρχει μια μεγάλη συζήτηση σε παγκόσμιο επίπεδο πλέον. Πώς δηλαδή θα συνδυάσουμε την πρόσβαση των πολιτών στα νέα αυτά καινοτόμα προϊόντα, τα οποία βεβαίως υπό την προϋπόθεση βεβαίως ότι αυτά τεκμηριώνεται η κλινική τους αποτελεσματικότητα, τεκμηριώνεται η θετική επίπτωσή τους στην πρόγνωση της νόσου, στην ποιότητα ζωής των ασθενών. Πώς θα συνδυαστεί λοιπόν η πρόσβαση, η ισότιμη πρόσβαση των ανθρώπων με την επιβίωση των δημόσιων συστημάτων υγείας και των ασφαλιστικών συστημάτων. Αυτό είναι μια πολύ μεγάλη πρόκληση και είναι μια διαρκής συζήτηση που πλέον έχει ανοίξει σε όλα τα επίσημα φόρα, τα πολιτικά και μέσα στην Ευρώπη αλλά νομίζω στον υπόλοιπο κόσμο. Και ο μόνος τρόπος για να απαντήσουμε θετικά σε αυτό είναι να βρούμε μια ισορροπία ανάμεσα στον έλεγχο της ζήτησης με επιστημονικά κριτήρια, με βάση τις διεθνείς κατευθυντήριες οδηγίες, τα διεθνώς αποδεκτά guidelines από τη μια και από την άλλη στην διαπραγμάτευση με τη βιομηχανία προσιτών και κοινωνικά αποδεκτών τιμών αποζημίωσης αυτών των νέων προϊόντων. Δεν υπάρχει άλλος τρόπος. Και οφείλουμε κι εμείς, μια χώρα σε δημοσιονομική πίεση, να βρούμε γρήγορα αυτή την ισορροπία, την καινούργια, ιδιαίτερα όσον αφορά τα φάρμακα, αλλά και τα υπόλοιπα είδη, να διασφαλίσουμε την πρόσβαση των πολιτών, των συνανθρώπων μας που έχουν πραγματική ανάγκη, με βάση την τεκμηρίωση, με βάση τα πρωτόκολλα, τα διαγνωστικά και τα θεραπευτικά, με βάση τα μητρώα ασθενών, να διασφαλίσουμε λοιπόν την πρόσβασή τους, αλλά ταυτόχρονα να πετύχουμε τιμές που να μπορεί να αντέξει μια χώρα σαν τη δική μας. Έχουμε πάρει αρκετές πρωτοβουλίες σε αυτό το επίπεδο και σε μια διαπραγμάτευση, δηλαδή εθνικού επίπεδου από τη μία και συνεργασιών με άλλες χώρες της Ευρώπης, έτσι ώστε να πετύχουμε συνέργειες που θα ενισχύσουν τη διαπραγματευτική μας δύναμη. Αυτός είναι ο στόχος και θεωρώ ότι σιγά σιγά μπορούν να υπάρξουν βήματα θετικά και μετρήσιμα αποτελεσματικότητα σε αυτές τις παρατάσεις. Κλείνω θέλοντας να εκφράσω την λελογισμένη αισιοδοξία που οφείλουμε να έχουμε αυτή την περίοδο, έχοντας επίγνωση των δυσκολιών, αλλά ταυτόχρονα έχοντας επίγνωση ότι αυτή η χώρα έχει ένα εξαιρετικό ανθρώπινο δυναμικό, έχει έντιμους, αξιόπιστους και παραγωγικούς ανθρώπους που έχουν πλέον την οριμότητα να επιβάλλουν μία αλλαγή πορείας, να επιβάλλουν μία υπέρβαση των γνωστών παθογενειών και στρεβλώσεων του παρελθόντος και συστρατευόμενοι να κάνουμε μια καινούργια αρχή και να πετύχουμε σε ένα σύντομο χρονικό διάστημα, πριν εξαντλήσουμε τις αντοχές της κοινωνίας, να πετύχουμε μια μεγάλη παραγωγική, κοινωνική, θεσμική και πολιτική ανασυγκρότηση της χώρας. Έχουμε καλή επιτυχία στο συνεδριό σας και καλή δύναμη στις προσπάθειες σας. Να είστε καλά.
Ask the representative of the main opposition party, Mr. Nikolaos Stavrakos, to come to give his message from his party to the Congress.
His position.
Να ζητήσω και εγώ συγγνώμη για τα ελληνικά και είναι βασικές αρχές που πρέπει να έχουμε. Σεβόμενοι τον τόπο μας, σεβόμενοι τις ιδέες μας, σεβόμενοι τις αρχές μας, να μιλάμε τη γλώσσα μας. Θα ήθελα να χαιρετήσω και να καλωσορίσω όλους τους συνέδρους, όλους τους καθηγητές Έλληνες και ξένους, τον κύριο Υπουργό που μας θυμάται την παρουσία του στον τόπο μας, την κυρία Αντιπεριφερειάρχη, τον κύριο Δήμαρχο, τον κύριο Βουλευτή, τους εκπροσώπους όσων φορέων βρίσκονται εδώ. Θα ήθελα να σας μεταφέρω τον χαιρετισμό του Αρχηγού της Νέας Δημοκρατίας, Κυριάκου Μητσοτάκη, που εύχεται στο συνέδριο καλά αποτελέσματα, καλή δουλειά, γιατί είναι κάτι που το πιστεύει. Είναι στις αρχές της Νέας Δημοκρατίας να βοηθάμε, να υποστηρίζουμε, να προωθούμε και να αγαπάμε τους ανθρώπους που είναι πρωτοπορία και φωτεινά παραδείγματα στην έρευνα και στην καινοτομία. Ο κύριος Γλάμος και η ομάδα του και οι καθηγητές που συνεργάζονται μαζί του είναι ένα φωτεινό παράδειγμα. Εμείς λοιπόν, σκεπτόμενοι και υποστηρίζοντας αυτές τις αρχές και τις αντιλήψεις, υποστηρίζουμε την πρωτοβουλία αυτή, υποστηρίζουμε το Πανεπιστήμιο, το Δημόσιο, Προσθέτουμε όμως και θέλουμε και επιμένουμε και προσπαθούμε τόσα χρόνια να πετύχουμε να συνεργάζεται το Δημόσιο Πανεπιστήμιο με την ιδιωτική πρωτοβουλία. Η ιδιωτική πρωτοβουλία έχει να προσφέρει στη χώρα μας και στηρίζεται στις βασικές αρχές και στις αντιλήψεις μας. Στις αντιλήψεις που ξεκίνησαν από αυτόν τον τόπο. Η Σπάρτη που στηριζόταν σε αυτή τη θεώρηση της ζωής. Μίλησε προηγουμένως ο κύριος καθηγητής για τη φιλοσοφία, την ελληνική και την αρχαία. Δυστυχώς για εμάς τους Έλληνες και δυστυχώς για εμάς τους Σπαρτιάτες, η σπαρτιάτικη φιλοσοφία και αντίληψη δεν έχει γίνει γνωστή, δεν έχει θεωρηθεί ότι είναι απαραίτητη να την γνωρίζουμε και εδώ δεν θέλω να πω κάτι άλλο, αφήνω αποσυμπητικά γιατί και πώς. Θα ήθελα λοιπόν να μιλήσω λίγο για το συγκεκριμένο συνέδριο, το οποίο έχει να κάνει με κάτι το οποίο θεωρείται πρωτοποριακό και όπως είπε και ο προηγούμενος ομιλητής, ο κύριος Υπουργός, αλλά και ο κύριος Καθηγητής, έχουν να κάνουν με τον τρόπο αντιμετώπισης κάποιων πραγμάτων. Εμείς πιστεύουμε ότι η πρωτοπορία και ειδικά η ανάπτυξη και η έρευνα όσον αφορά αυτά τα θέματα, τα οποία βοηθούν στην πρόληψη, και αυτό είναι το συγκεκριμένη προσπάθεια και έρευνα στηρίζεται σε αυτό το αντικείμενο, στην πρόληψη των ασθενειών, έχει να κάνει με τη βοήθεια στην οικονομία, στην ισορροπία και το βασικότερο στην καλύτερη ποιότητα ζωής. Θα βοηθήσει λοιπόν σε μια καλύτερη κοινωνία, σε μια καλύτερη ανάπτυξη, σε μια οικονομική προσπάθεια η οποία θα κοστίσει πολύ λιγότερο. Δεν είναι ο χώρος και η ώρα να αναλύσουμε τα οικονομικά, κοινωνικά ωφέλη που θα έχουμε από τέτοιες ανακαλύψεις οι οποίες βοηθούν την πρόληψη. Η υγεία μας λοιπόν και ειδικά στο χώρο μας, ο πληθυσμός γεράσκει, δυστυχώς, θα πρέπει να ακολουθήσουμε την πρόληψη. Η πρόληψη λοιπόν στηρίζεται σε πρωτοποριακές έρευνες που θα συνδυάζονται με μειωμένα έξοδα, μειωμένα ασφάλιστα που είναι της εποχής τώρα και δημιουργούνται πάρα πολλά προβλήματα, ειδικά τώρα που η χώρα μας περνάει αυτή την κρίση. Με όλα αυτά λοιπόν θα κοιτάξουμε στο μέλλον να βοηθήσουμε, να συνεργαστούμε, να συνυπάρξουμε για να έχουμε μια καλύτερη κοινωνία και ένα καλύτερο αύριο. Εύχομαι το συνέδριό σας να φέρει τα καλύτερα αποτελέσματα, να ευαισθητοποιήσει περισσότερο κόσμο και να ευχαριστήσω, τελειώνοντας εδώ, να ευχαριστήσω όλους όσους βοήθησαν στο να γίνει στη Σπάρτη, στη Λακωνία, που για μας η Λακωνία, τη Νέα Δημοκρατία, όπως ξέρετε, είναι το προφίλιο μας. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
To ask the Vice Head of Regional Unit of Laconia, Mrs. Adamadia Zanetea.
Minister of Health, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome you to the blessed Earth of Laconia and to its historical capital, Sparta. It is a great opportunity for all the visitors who are here for the Congress to get to know Laconia better, its beautiful sites, the historical monuments. At this point, I would like to say the beginning of the second Congress, GeNeDis. I would also like to thank Mr. Βλάμος, Παναγιώτης Βλάμος. Παναγιώτη, σε ευχαριστούμε πάρα πολύ for choosing Sparta as the location to hold this Congress. The region of Peloponnese supports the second Congress that will enhance the scientific research and at the same time will help our city become more well known to the public. I wish the best of success to the GeNeDis Congress and my thanks go to everyone who was working for it. I wish everyone a pleasant time in Sparta. Σας ευχαριστούμε λοιπόν για να σεβαστώ και εγώ τη γλώσσα μας στην, για την παραμονή σας εδώ. Σας ευχαριστούμε κύριε Λάμου που επιλέξατε τη Σπάρτη για το συνέδριο και που σε συνεργασία με όλους τους φορείς στηρίξαμε γιατί πιστεύουμε ότι προάγει και την επιστήμη αλλά στηρίζει και τον τόπο μας. Καλή επιτυχία έχουμε.
From Corfu, the head of the region of Ionian Islands, Mr. Thodoris Galiatsatos, who came today, especially for the Congress from Corfu.
Κύριε Αντιπεριφερειάρχη, κύριε Δήμαρχη, κύριε Βουλευτή, κυρίες και κύριοι συνεδροί. Ως Περιφέρεια Ιωνίζων, χαιρετίζουμε τη διεξαγωγή του δεύτερου Παγκόσμιου Συνεδρίου Γενετικής, Γεριατρικής και Έρευνας στις Νευροεκφυγιστικές Νόσους εδώ στην όμορφη Σπάρτη. Η παρουσία εδώ κορυφαίων επιστημόνων και ερευνητών από όλο τον κόσμο. Οι συζητήσεις που θα λάβουν χώρα για τις μεγάλες προκλήσεις στην επιστημονική έρευνα. Οι νέοι στόχοι που θα τεθούν για τις φαρμακευτικές ουσίες, την ανάπτυξη των βιολογικών δικτών, την έγκαιρη διάγνωση των νευροεκφυγιστικών ασθενειών, καθιστούν το συνέδριο αυτό εξαιρετικά σημαντικό για την επιστημονική έρευνα με επίκεντρο τον άνθρωπο. Ως Περιφέρεια Ιωνίζων, συγχαίρουμε το Εργαστήριο Βιοπληροφορικής και ανθρώπινης ηλεκτροφυσιολογίας του Τμήματος Πληροφορικής του Ιωνίου Πανεπιστημίου για την πρωτοβουλία της οργάνωσης του συνεδρίου αυτού και αισθανόμαστε υπερήφανοι για την καταξίωσή του στον χώρο της παγκόσμιας επιστημονικής έρευνας. Αποτέλεσμα ασφαλώς της έμπνευσης, του σχεδιασμού και της σκληρής δουλειάς των στελεχών. Η παρουσία μας εδώ σήμερα υποδηλώνει το ισχυρό ενδιαφέρον μας για την πρόθεση της έρευνας στους κρίσιμους τομείς που πραγματεύεται το συνέδριο και ταυτόχρονα τη δέσμευσή μας για τη συνέχιση της στήριξης των προσπαθειών αυτών ανεξάρτητα από τις δυσκολίες της πολιτικής και οικονομικής συγκυρίας. Εύχομαι, αγαπητοί κυρίες και κύριοι σύνεδροι, κάθε επιτυχία στο δεύτερο συνέδριό σας επ' αγαθό της ανθρώπινης ύπαρξης και μακροημέρευσης. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Κύριε Υπουργέ, κύριε Περιφερειάρχη, κύριε Περιφερειάρχη, κύριε Δήμαρχε, σεβάσμιοι κύριοι καθηγητές, κυρίες και κύριοι, είναι μεγάλη μας χαρά και τιμή να φιλοξενούμε στο νομό μας το δεύτερο Παγκόσμιο Συνέδριο αυτού του τομέα. Έρχεται σε μια εποχή κατά την οποία οι νευροεκφυγιστικές ασθένειες αρχίζουν να παίρνουν το χώρο που τους ανήκουν. Μέχρι τώρα υπήρχε ενδεχομένως μία σύγχυση μεταξύ των νευροεκφυγιστικών ασθενειών και της γυριατρικής. Πολλές ασθένειες οι οποίες εκδηλώνονταν σε μεγάλη ηλικία και αφορούσαν νευροεκφυγιστικές ασθένειες, παθήσεις, συγχαίονταν πολλές φορές με την γυριατρική. Όμως, από ό,τι φαίνεται, η επιστήμη προχωρά. Η διάγνωση γίνεται όλο και συντομότερη, όλο και σε πιο πρώιμα στάδια και ταυτόχρονα μια σειρά από είτε φυσικών ουσιών, όπως η ελαιοκαθάνδη που είχε γίνει ένα αντίστοιχο συνέδριο συστατικό του ελαιολάδου πριν από λίγο καιρό στην Ολυμπία, είτε μέθοδοι οι οποίες μπορούν να προγνώσουν νωρίτερα την ασθένεια, όπως θα παρουσιαστούν στο σημερινό συνέδριο από ό,τι έχουν πληροφορίες, έρχονται λοιπόν να δώσουν λύσεις και απαντήσεις πιο νωρίς και πιο καλά. Είναι λοιπόν από αυτή την άποψη πάρα πολύ σημαντικό να δούμε και τη διασύνδεση της έρευνας με τους χρήστες υγείας, τα αποτελέσματα των ερευνών, τον κόπο σας δηλαδή, να διασυνδεθούν με τους χρήστες υγείας, τους ασθενείς. Η δημόσια δωρεάν καθολική πρόσβαση στην υγεία, την οποία επιχειρούμε το τελευταίο διάστημα, έχει ακριβώς να κάνει με αυτό το πράγμα, με την απολαβή δηλαδή των αποτελεσμάτων της έρευνας σε όλο και μεγαλύτερο εύρος ασθενών, χωρίς αυτό να είναι προνόμιο των ολίγων οι οποίοι μπορούν να διαθέσουν κεφάλαια, να διαθέσουν χρήματα για να έχουν πρόσβαση σε αυτές τις απολαβές υγείας. Για αυτούς τους λόγους είναι μεγάλη μας τιμή που φιλοξενούμε εδώ το συνέδριό σας και ευχόμαστε από κάθε άποψη καλή επιτυχία. Να είστε καλά.
Κύριε Υπουργέ, κύριε Περιφερειάρχη, κυρία Περιφερειάρχη, κύριε Βουλευτέ, σεβαστοί καθηγητές, με μεγάλη χαρά σας καλωσορίζουμε στην πόλη της Σπάρτης. Ήταν για μας τιμή να συμμετέχουμε στη συνδιοργάνωση αυτού του συνεδρίου. Θεωρούμε ότι ήταν απαραίτητο να γίνει στην πόλη της Σπάρτης. Ξέχωρα από την ιστορία που διακατέχει την πόλη της Σπάρτης, θεωρούμε ότι έχει και τα εχέγγυα η πόλη και η περιοχή μας για να μπορείτε και να σκεφτείτε και να συνεδριάσετε σε αυτόν τον υπέροχο τόπο. Ταυτόχρονα και τα προϊόντα μας και η περιοχή ειδίκεται να προχωρήσετε στην έρευνα και στην διαστοιχεία που και η φύση μας προσφέρει αρκετά. Εύχομαι καλή επιτυχία στο συνεδριό σας και θεωρούμε τέτοια συνέδρια μπορούμε σαν πόλη και σαν Λακωνία να διοργανώνουμε με επιτυχία. Συγχαρητήρια στον κύριο καθηγητή για την πρωτοβουλία που πήρε και στο Πανεπιστήμιο Ιόνια που ήρθε εδώ να γίνει συνέδριο. Σας καλωσορίζουμε στην πόλη μας.
The Vice Rector of the University of Peloponnese, Mrs. Sofia Zigan.
Καλησπέρα σε όλους, dear Minister of Health, honored guests, dear Chairman, Παναγιώτη Γλαμμό. It is a great pleasure to welcome you today in Sparta at the start of the Second World Congress on GeNeDis. The organization of this major event is a joint effort of Ionian University, Wilfrid Laurier University, University of the Peloponnese, Technological Educational Institute of Ionian Islands, Municipality of Sparta, and the region of Peloponnese. I'm really proud that our university is participating in the organization of a congress with such a global scope and so highly esteemed scholars, and I would like to congratulate all those who contribute in this organization. The participation of the University of the Peloponnese in the organization of this major symposium confirms its dynamic presence. Although it is a young university, it is developing rapidly and contributes of high quality innovative research. We invest in knowledge and in diffusing knowledge to the advantage of society. I hope that this Congress will lead to further research synergies, and I look forward to the participation of our university in future international projects. Thank you, Rector Konstantinos Mancelos. Και εγώ με τη σειρά μου θα ήθελα να σας καλωσορίσω στην ελληνική πια γλώσσα, στην πόλη της Σπάρτης. Ευχαριστώ ιδιαίτερα τον κύριο Βλάμο για την αξιόλογη αυτή συνεργασία μαζί με το Πανεπιστήμιο Πελοποννήσου. Θεωρώ ότι αυτό το συνέδριο πραγματικά θα μας κάνει όλους να νιώθουμε περίφημα και περήφανοι για την εξαιρετική δουλειά και τη συνεργασία που έχουμε. Θεωρώ ότι μέσα από αυτή τη συνεργασία καταφέραμε ερευνητικά να ενώσουμε τις δυνάμεις μας, τόσο το Τμήμα Διαχείρισης και Οργάνωσης Αθλητισμού, όσο και το Τμήμα Νοσηλευτικής, αλλά και το τμήμα πληροφορικής, να συνδυάσουμε λοιπόν τις δυνάμεις μας και να καταφέρουμε με τη βοήθεια της πολιτείας, οπωσδήποτε, του Υπουργείου μας, της Περιφέρειας και του Δήμου μας, να προχωρήσουμε αυτή την ερευνητική συνεργασία και να καταφέρουμε κάτι καλό, γιατί αυτό θα σχετίζεται με την ποιότητα ζωής των ασθενών. Σας ευχαριστώ ιδιαίτερα για την τιμητική πρόσκληση και εύχομαι στο συνέδριό μας καλή επιτυχία.
He's a professor of physics and computer science of Wilfrid Laurier University of Canada, which is one of the co-organizers of the GeNeDis professor.
Thank you very much, Kalimeras, dear government officials, colleagues, students, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor for me to participate in organizing this conference. I must congratulate Professor Panagiotis Lamos for all his efforts and his collaborators. They deserve a very big round of applause. My own expertise is in computer science and mathematics. I'm working somewhere between those two areas. And I'm looking forward to learn at this conference the kind of computational problems that appear in this research area and hopefully be able to contribute. Θα ήθελα να σας ευχαριστήσω, ας θα πω και εγώ στα ελληνικά. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ για την παρουσία σας. Είναι πάρα πολύ μεγάλη τιμή για μένα και για το Πανεπιστήμιο μου, το οποίο βρίσκεται στο Οντάριο του Καναδά, να συμμετάσχει σε αυτή την εκδήλωση. Είναι η πρώτη, πιστεύω ότι δεν θα είναι η τελευταία. Σας ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Professor Blaumstein.
Let us welcome Professor Pantelis Yannakopoulos. He's professor at the University of Lausanne, at the Department of Psychiatry, University of Geneva School of Medicine. He was born in Athens in 1965, where he achieved his education in medical studies before specializing in the Faculty of Medicine in Geneva, where he graduated as private docent in 1997. In 1999, he achieved the board certification as specialist in psychiatry and psychotherapy, followed in 2008 by the board certification in old age psychiatry and psychotherapy. And in 2010, he added the board certification in liaison psychiatry. In 2005, he becomes head of the psychiatry department of the Geneva University Hospital. And he developed an interest, an early interest in dementia, as well as in Alzheimer's disease, which led him to be elected several times by the Swiss National Fund for Research since 1994. The ongoing work at the Faculty of Medicine at the Geneva University is a patient-oriented research, together with a translational research addressing the following topics. Patient-oriented research, identification of EEG markers, identification of biological and neuropsychological markers of cognitive decline in elderly patients, cognitive impact of vascular lesions in brain aging, translational research, stereological assessment of AD-related lesions, use of recombinant clustering to prevent ischemic damage in organotype cultures. Furthermore, a European Research Fund has granted Professor Pantelis Yannakopoulos together with other main researchers in the topic of the identification of functional and structural biomarkers of AD. We are very glad to have him here.
Στα ελληνικά στην αρχή, ευχαριστώ πολύ, κύριε Βλάμου, για την τιμή που μου δίνει να έρχομαι εδώ και να σας μιλήσω για το θέμα της έρευνας που με απασχόλησε τα τελευταία, θα έλεγα, 20 χρόνια. Είμαι ψυχίατρος και ψυχοθεραπευτής, θα είναι ο Δημητής. Στην προκειμένη περίπτωση θα σας μιλήσω για το Alzheimer, το speech in English. I would like during the next few minutes give you an overview of the current situation of research in Alzheimer's disease, and in particular in the field of biomarkers, since biomarkers will be a main focus of this Congress. So to start, just to say that 25 years ago, when I was first interested by Alzheimer's research, there was a quite dichotomic approach of dementia in general, and also of the other psychiatric disease. That means on one hand we had the pathology, and on the other hand the normality. And then progressively our understanding of Alzheimer's disease and associated conditions has dramatically changed with the introduction of a transitory zone between dementia and normality, what we call it, mostly what the people call it, MCI, the mild cognitive impairment. It was the first attempt to define an intermediate group, that means a group with some cognitive changes, some static cognitive changes, and on the other hand, with quite preserved, or at that time, we supposed that it was preserved, brain structure. The idea was that with the prevention, it would be much easier to treat this kind of persons, persons who were not classified as patients, long before the clinically overt Alzheimer's disease. And then, during the last 10 years, we progressively moved toward normality with the identification of what we call it right now preclinical phases of Alzheimer's disease. First the prodromal phases and then the preclinical phases of Alzheimer's disease, essentially based on the combination of very subtle cognitive deficits within the normal range, in fact, and the addition of biomarkers. And what was a main change in Alzheimer's disease research is the progressive introduction of predictive biomarkers. And in fact, in neuropsychiatry, for the moment at least, it is the only disease with such advanced stage of knowledge in terms of biomarkers, their utility, also their limits. I would like to give you also not only good news, but also probably start by the bad news and then move to the good news regarding Alzheimer's disease. So, Alzheimer's disease has been described more than a century ago by Alois Alzheimer, and in fact, it was also the first attempt to put together a behavioral change, a very well characterized behavioral change, which at that time was in the field of psychiatry, since the first patient with Alzheimer's disease described presented with delusional ideas of jealousy, and the presence of lesions in the human brain. Two types of lesions, without entering into details, the accumulation of amyloid, the amyloid plaques that you can see here, and also the progressive damage in neural populations with the accumulation of abnormal forms of cytoskeletal proteins, what we call neurofibrillary tangles, and then the destruction of the neurons. So, I skip a very important part of the research made in early 90s to go to the main issue of this conference, that means how we can treat Alzheimer's disease, what were the etiological hypotheses for Alzheimer's disease. In fact, there was one major etiological hypothesis that drove the research in Alzheimer's for at least 35 years, is the amyloid hypothesis. That means that the accumulation of amyloid in the human brain will be pathologic, and at the end of the day will induce neural damage, loss of neurons, and the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease. This hypothesis is much more complex than what I described right now, but for several years was not necessarily translated into clinical trials. For almost 3-4 decades, we had no curative treatments in Alzheimer's disease. And then we developed
the first vaccines, the first attempts to use vaccines against amyloid, with the idea that we would be able to stop the progression of Alzheimer's disease. It was a tremendous change. Before, our treatment was essentially symptomatic treatment, a palliative treatment, if you like. And then we tried, at the beginning of the 21st century, to move into curative treatment with the use of what we call anti-amyloid therapy, anti-amyloid antibodies in the human brain. We must say that the animal models were very promising from this point of view. The first results were really fantastic, with the possibility really to delay amyloid plaques in the brains of rodents using these antibodies. So you can see here how the research evolved in this field. In 2002, with the idea that the development of these therapeutics not only will help patients, but also will prove the correctness of the amyloid hypothesis. And then, progressively, the accumulation of negative data. What worked in rodents, not worked in humans. So the results in 2008, 9, and later on, were essentially negative results with the amyloid treatments. These were the bad news here. Of course, even large cohort studies with clinically overt Alzheimer's disease gave negative data. So, of course, we had already doubts about the correctness of the amyloid hypothesis with the idea that if we take the example of Alzheimer's disease, 3 days ago I gave one conference on Down syndrome and the interface with Alzheimer's disease. Down syndrome is an intellectual deficit syndrome associated with the development of full amyloid pathology as early as 8 years. However, not all cases develop Alzheimer's disease. The second doubt was that the accumulation of amyloid was not really related to the severity of the disease. Most of the studies showed more than 20 years ago that this relationship does not really exist. And of course, there are other doubts. For instance, the fact that the use of soluble forms of amyloid, that means that the amyloid in the brain can be found in two main forms, an intracellular form, a soluble amyloid form, and then the accumulation of fibril amyloid deposits in the brain, extracellularly. And this soluble amyloid, was in fact one of the explanations used to explain why the trials against the fibril amyloid gave negative results. The interpretation was that, well, in fact, it's the wrong target. The target should be soluble amyloid and not fibril amyloid. But in fact, the soluble amyloid in Alzheimer's disease mouse model does not correlate with cognitive deficits. And in fact, it's also present in postmortem Alzheimer's disease specimens, but not in controls. Of course, this is a very important difference compared to fibril amyloid. There are too many spans of soluble amyloids. It is difficult to define their toxicity. And in fact, this is the case in vivo, but also in vitro. Next slide. The failure of therapeutic trials, in fact, even for the primary endpoints, gave a very strong disappointment in the Alzheimer's disease community. At the end of the 2010, in fact, most industries were very reluctant to invest in Alzheimer's disease research because of these results. But why? Why we fail? Of course, there are several interpretations. One was that it was not early enough. That means that we selected quite advanced cases. And in advanced Alzheimer's disease cases, of course, there are several deficits, not only cognitive deficits, but also loss of neurons, loss of synapse, and in fact, there are irreversible damage that occur in the human brain. So one explanation was that we needed to select more carefully early cases. Another explanation, of course, that was that the vaccine was not clinically carefully validated. And the third one, that of course it was not the good thing. And that's where we stand right now in terms of anti-amyloid trials. But you should consider that worldwide there are tremendous efforts to test preclinical population or population with MCI, with the idea that if we are early enough, it will be possible to change the fate of Alzheimer's disease. Well, the first data in MCI showed that we have no real gain using anti-amyloid therapy. It is not really surprising because MCI, the mild cognitive impairment, is not so early in terms of biology. It's rather a late stage in terms of the Alzheimer's disease pathology, since substantial development of amyloid deposits and also neurofibrillary tangles are present in this population. So right now there are very, very important trials, the DIAN and the 81 trials in presymptomatic individuals at risk for Alzheimer's disease using more advanced and probably better forms of anti-amyloid immunotherapy. We expect the first results after 2.5-3 years. But this tendency to move from clinically over cases to rather early cases and then to preclinical cases opened the field of biomarker search in Alzheimer's disease. And in fact, the main question that we'd like to address here is whether we are able to identify individually, not only statistically, the risk to develop Alzheimer's disease in an individual. In a given person rather than passion. And the focus, in fact, is now moves towards secondary prevention. And we need to integrate the effects of Alzheimer's disease changes, but not only. The brain is a living organism, in fact. And the brain has the capacity to compensate, has the capacity to defend itself against the accumulation of lesions. As an example, in fact, and the brain aging is a beautiful example to the possibility that the human brain has to compensate for instance, the deficient activation of some cortical areas with a compensatory activation of other cortical areas in order to keep the cognitive performance at the correct level. So, a main question of the research on biomarkers is also the definition of the right temporal window for a future curative treatment. Of course, too early is problematic. Too early is problematic because there are ethical problems. This immunotherapy is not without secondary effects, in some cases even with severe secondary effects. And also, in these cases, functional compensation possibly is also present, so there is no need to be very aggressive. On the other hand, if we are too late, there are irreversible structural damages, and in that case, we have no real hope to obtain positive results. In fact, Alzheimer's disease became right now the example of what personalized medicine will give us in the field of neuropsychiatry, possibly after 20 years for the other psychiatric disease. We should consider that for schizophrenia, for bipolar disorders, for other illness, we are at an embryonic state in terms of biomarkers compared to what the progress of neuroscience gave us in Alzheimer's disease. Still, this progress opens also new questions and show us the limits of our possibility also for using biomarkers in the prediction of the future of persons with cognitive decline. So I would like to summarize very quickly the results that we obtained with biomarkers and then focus on new data and very, very exciting data on beta amyloid in tau imaging. So there is a panel of biomarkers already well established in mild cognitive impairment. Without being over optimistic, I can say that in fact in MCI we can predict the evolution of Alzheimer's disease using the biomarkers with a very high sensitivity and specificity. It's not at an individual level, but we have sensitivity specificity around 0.8, 0.9 for some of the biomarkers. But of course not for healthy persons, but for MCI, that means for persons with already altered cognition. Here you can see a summary of the biomarkers that are used in memory clinics in Europe and the United States. So first, the neuropsychological markers of MCI conversion, that means for the transition from MCI to Alzheimer's disease, as you can see, pre-recall, delayed recall, semantic memory tests, altogether it can give us sensitivity specificity rather low, lower than 0.7. But we have a very good structural marker, and in fact, MRI remains a very precious tool in this context. Since the rate of medial temporal lobe atrophy and the smaller hippocampal or entorhinal volumes at baseline is associated with a threefold increase of the conversion in the MCI to Alzheimer's disease. One main question that the doctor should ask to a neuroradiologist is the state of the hippocampus, the entorhinal cortex, when you try to identify MCI cases at risk to develop Alzheimer's disease, at high risk to develop Alzheimer's disease. Of course, besides structural changes, we have also metabolic tools. We have the example of the decreased metabolic rates at rest in posterior cingulate cortex, the posterior cingulate cortex parietal and right temporal parietal cortex, that means the posterior part of the brain. Early metabolic changes in this context is associated with sensitivity specificity values for the transition to Alzheimer's disease around 0.8. So 0.8 is already something. It's not perfect, but it's already something. And FDG PET is used for tau cases in MCI. It's integrated in the battery of tests that we use it in memory clinic. Of course, we can also move not only to the metabolic aspect of the brain, not only the imaging, but also to the molecular expression of the disease, using the CSF measures, the measures in this cerebrospinal fluid, of the tau, of the total tau, the phospho-tau, remember, is the protein that becomes pathologic when neurofibrillary tangles are developed in the human brain. And the combination of tau and amyloid, CSF amyloid, A-beta-42, is the pathological peptide causing amyloid plaques, predict conversion with very high sensitivities in MCI. You can see that in some, at least in some studies, the sensitivities are around 0.995, with specificities around 0.8. So very good results for MCI. The replication are not in animals in this context, and for the moment the best molecular marker widely accepted in the new research criteria for Alzheimer's disease is the ratio between the phospho-tau and the A-beta-42. So I would like right now to move to the last word, in fact, in terms of neuroimaging, that means beta amyloid and PET tau imaging. Why is the last word for the moment? Is because we have been able, and this story starts already 7 to 8 years ago, to visualize not only the damage in the human brain, but the lesions in the human brain. And it was unexpected. I mean, when I started medicine in the University of Athens, if someone tells me that we will be able to visualize in vivo lesions of Alzheimer's disease, I will consider that it was a dreamer. But in fact, right now, we are able to visualize lesions. Using the beta amyloid, The beta amyloid imaging give us the possibility to visualize the progressive accumulation of the amyloid in the human brain. But of course, give us the opportunity to revisit some of our theories and our beliefs in this context. Here you can see how the amyloid is accumulated in the human brain from normality to intermediate cases and then to Alzheimer's disease dementia. As you can see, it is true that progressively, is the red color, there is an accumulation of amyloid in the intermediate cases, even control cases with amyloid deposition, and then in Alzheimer's disease. But one observation is very critical here. As you can see, there is a very important overlap in terms of the deposition of amyloid. If you compare, you can see that between control and MCI, there is, of course, an increase in terms of amyloid. But between MCI and Alzheimer's disease dementia, is much less clear. That means that the possibility to use the beta amyloid is very important in the very early stages of the disease, preclinically, but becomes much less sexy in terms of prediction when we move from MCI to Alzheimer's disease. The overlap is very important. Here you can see the progression from cognitive normal cases without amyloid to cognitive normal cases with amyloid and then to Alzheimer's disease dementia. As you can see, it was very nicely demonstrated, the amyloid deposition reached a plateau before the occurrence of the first clinical symptoms, and almost 25 to 30% of cognitive intact cases have amyloid. It's a main problem in Alzheimer's disease research when we talk about our lesions that are already present in the human brain after 55, 60 years of age, without any clinical expression in all cases. So we cannot have a dichotomic approach between normality and pathology in Alzheimer's disease because of the nature of the lesions. Here you can see a longitudinal follow-up of the accumulation of amyloid in the human brain. To make a long story short, you can see the red vectors the green vectors. Green vectors represent essentially cases that remain cognitively stable or progress to MCI, whereas the red vectors show a progression to Alzheimer's disease. As you can see, it is true that there is a difference between normal cases with very low amyloid deposits and cases that progress to Alzheimer's disease with higher amyloid deposits from 1.5 to 2.3, 2.4. Right now, the cutoff point is the 2.3. But when we try to examine the increase, the progressive increase of amyloid in Alzheimer's disease, in cases that develop Alzheimer's disease, and in other forms of dementia, you see already an overlap. You see that it's much more difficult to differentiate also cases of Alzheimer's disease dementia to non-Alzheimer's disease dementia based on the signal amyloid signal. And most importantly, in advanced Alzheimer's disease cases, the amount of amyloid remains stable. As you can see, it does not exceed 3.3 in this scale with a cutoff of 1.5. That means that after that someone developed the first time of Alzheimer's disease, amyloid deposition remains quite stable. It cannot be used as a marker for the follow-up of the disease. It's probably very important in the early stages. It's associated with memory loss in the early stages, and it's very well demonstrated for memory, but also for other cognitive functions, with a decrease in the performance associated with the increase in amyloid deposits. But here is a very, very interesting example of the overlap between, in terms of amyloid, between MCI, Alzheimer's disease, and of course you can see that even in control cases you have amyloid, in several cases which you had amyloid, you have an increase in MCI, but between MCI and Alzheimer's disease, the increase is not really significant. That means that the game is played before the clinical expression of Alzheimer's disease. So what about preclinical cases? What amyloid gives us for preclinical cases? The performance within the normal limits, but with high risk for disease progression, we know that the accumulation of amyloid in normal individuals is associated with higher risk for developing cognitive decline. It is also, even most important, is a negative finding. If you don't have amyloid, the risk to develop after 5 years an Alzheimer's disease is extremely small. So in preclinical cases, normal controls. So probably it's a better marker of brain health than a marker that allows a good follow-up over time of the cognitive decline. Amyloid positivity is found in almost 70% of MCI cases. And of course, it's not a benign phenomenon, but it is possibly promising for early intervention if someone believes in the amyloid theory. There are, of course, some caveats, as described before. Absence of strong association between deposits and cognitive measures. Plateau before symptomatic phases. In several cases, which have a very clear Alzheimer's disease-like decline and neurodegeneration without amyloid deposition. So the amount of amyloid is more relevant than the topography in the human brain in preclinical stages. But it's not a disease marker in clinically over cases. It was the first limitation that we can state in this context regarding this pioneer method for detection of lesions in vivo. More recently, here we move in data from the last 4 years, in fact, we developed ligands for neuronal pathology in Alzheimer's disease, and we finish in with this image and the comment on tau imaging. Tau imaging allows for identified neurons, sick neurons in the human brain, and not, of course, in all areas, but in key areas such as the hippocampal formation. Why tau is different? Tau is different from amyloid because there is a pattern of development in the human brain. It's a major constituent of the NFT. There are several mutant forms associated with what we call tauopathies in the absence of amyloid. It's very strongly related to cognitive decline in Alzheimer's disease, but most importantly, there is a neurological progression which parallels symptoms. Not all areas are equally vulnerable to the cellular destruction of Alzheimer's disease. You have some areas, such as the hippocampus, the temporal neocortex, the parietal neocortex later on, which are quite vulnerable. On the other hand, you have some areas very preserved by neurofibrillary tinnitus. Is the case of cerebellum, for instance, is the case of some of the occipital, of the parts of the occipital neocortex. So there are differential patterns of vulnerability in for neurofibrillary tinnitus development. And the tau-related markers may become positive in the absence of amyloid deposit, essentially in preclinical cases. There are, of course, differences, and here I make a link with the technical part, which will be very important in this conference. There are differences in terms of visualization. It's not an easy task to visualize tau in the human brain with high levels of specificity. Why? First, because it is intracellular and not extracellular as the amyloid deposits. There are several forms, intrastructural forms, with post-translational modifications. And is substantially larger than amyloid, but on the other hand, the concentration of the pathological tau is much lower than that of A beta. And of course, there is a distant cortical distribution. Until now, the ligands that we developed have a good sensitivity, but we need to improve their specificity. So there are several steps in order to obtain very good ligands to visualize tau in the human brain and its pathology with high sensitivity selectivity, with low toxicity and no metabolites, with high level of lipophilicity, and of course selectivity to overcome the amyloid competitive value. And of course you need to have also the use of fluor for longer imaging times and the use of carbon labeling for multiple scans. So, in a world, in fact, a technical progress is needed before a clinical application of of this type of ligands. We can skip this one. Tau versus A beta imaging, advantage and disadvantage. You can assess, of course, the quantity of a regional distribution of tau deposits. It could be essential for assessing the disease progression. There are very encouraging data from this point of view. It's useful for the differential diagnosis of tauopathies, and it is pertinent to explore tau pathology, of course, in A beta negative cases. It is a complementary approach. In a future, not so oneric future, we will be able to combine these types of imaging in the clinical reality. Of course, thereafter, there is the question of the interpretation, essentially for preclinical cases. What will be the message for persons who are not patients? And I mean, when we open the question of the secondary prevention of Alzheimer's disease, whether working at the same time very difficult ethical problems. What kind of communication in persons without, for instance, symptoms, but with positive biomarkers? What kind of certainty? What kind of time? So here are the first data, some first data, with a comparison between amyloid and tau here. And I'd like that you observe the very important difference between the two approaches. For amyloid, the increase takes place in the normal brain, and then, moving to dementia, there is a very low supplementary increase. In the right part, the tau increases very progressively, even in dementia cases. So it follows, in fact, the severity of the disease. And that's the main message that I would like to give you in terms of tau PET imaging right now. Some examples to see that there is no only laboratory findings, but real life. Here a case with amyloid PET, with a negative amyloid PET, so without amyloid deposits, right part, and with the first signs of amyloid deposition in the brain, right here, so in the mesial temporal lobe, around the hippocampus. Much less than Alzheimer's disease, of course, in a normal case, 71 years old, with an MSE score, so with or 29, that means preserved cognition. Second case, here we have a case with amyloid positive cases, so with amyloid in the neocortex, even widespread amyloid deposition in the neocortex. And then an MSE score compatible with mild cognitive impairment, that means first cognitive problems. And here you can see the progressive increase of tau signals in the hippocampus and mesial temporal lobe. It's very, very interesting to see this progression. Third slide is the last one. In the amyloid negative Alzheimer's disease cases, that means cases very a total quality decline with essentially for memory, as you can see here, the binding of tau, pathological tau, is increased in the medial temporal lobe. That means that in case with amyloid negativity and amyloid positivity, we can follow the cognitive fate of this case using tau. Of course, these are, for the moment, anecdotic cases. There are several cases and several a substantial number of cases already done, but we have not real large cohorts of cases characterized with tau binding for the moment. So here is the evolution of the memory decline related to tau. Without surprise, you have a decrease of memory performance when you have an increase in the tau signal, of course. What is important to see here is that this decrease essentially concerns amyloid positive cases more than amyloid negative cases. You can see here with the red circles that in fact the decrease in the performance with the parallel increase in tau binding, the decrease in performance is much more frequent in amyloid positive cases, suggesting a synergistic effect between amyloid and tau in this context. So to conclude, that this last part, very recent and modern part of PET imaging in Alzheimer's disease. Needless to say that this kind of PET cannot be obtained for other neurological disease or psychiatric disease. We don't have this possibility for the moment. So give us some views for the future, some hopes for the future, but show us also the limits, the first limits of our understanding. In contrast to tau accumulation, a beta deposit is not really not a marker of cognitive decline. It's essentially a marker of early vulnerability to develop cognitive decline later on. Tau imaging seems to be more suitable as a biomarker of disease progression. Of course, amyloid pathology is not the only player here, but its presence potentializes tau pathology, increases its cognitive impact. And of course, it's not related per se to cognition. What is absent here, and is the additional player, is the imaging concerning the compensatory mechanism of the human brain. What I show here is essentially a lesional approach to disease, tau A beta. But we know it's quite surprising to see how little we know about the compensation abilities and what the brain can do to escape from Alzheimer's disease in terms of brain mechanism activated in a moment in the evolution of the disease, but even before. That will be the future challenge in terms of modern neuroimaging in this exciting field. Thank you for your attention.
Excellent talk. You really set the stage for the rest of the discussion. I just wanted to be the devil's advocate and say a few words in support of the amyloid hypothesis, although I'm not like the devotee. Main two arguments that in fact, I actually had a recent discussion with Ben Salk on that, and so I'm really doing devil's advocate in that regard. So the main argument is that all genetic causes of Alzheimer's disease, definitely the ones that are familiar with the autosomal disease, but Dr. Sato would also claim the sporadic ones, all genes somehow mechanistically involve A beta. So how do you respond to that?
No, it's a non-debate. Of course, the genetic argument was the main argument of amyloid theory. One could imagine that there are several independent cascades in this context, because on the other hand, without tau, you don't have dementia. Without amyloid, you can have dementia. And that's the main arguments against. Yeah, there are several tauopathies without amyloid, but with tau pathology. There are, I mean, these two arguments are rather incomplete arguments. I'm not so sure that tau and amyloid are the best targets for future treatments. What we see is the expression of the lesions. We don't see necessarily underlying the pathological process. And we should also consider that genetic cases is, despite what Dan tells, is a minority of cases, really, in early onset. So there is no definite answer to that. It is probably true that amyloid play a role in the initial stages. I was very disappointed because we have participated to the vaccination trial for MCI, and was quite disappointed to see that even in MCI cases, the amyloid vaccination was not gave not result, not positive results. At early stages, it is true that it influences very clearly the evolution of the neurodegenerative process. I'm not sure that this the key player in the transition of dementia. So that's the real question. What would we like to treat? Are we able, for instance, to treat amyloid with the idea that the rest will not follow? True? We don't know very well. Are we able, will be able to treat at the tau level later on? But on the other hand, tau is a very capricious molecule, so not so easy to give treatments. No, there are several open questions for two decades of things.
A quick one.
I enjoyed very much your talk. Thank you very much. Some groups, and one of them is the group of the University of Athens of Paraskevas and Kapaki, have found that if you study in the cerebral spinal fluid tau and amyloid and phospho-tau, and you get the ratio between amyloid and tau, you really distinguish between Alzheimer's disease and normal controls or other dementias. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it's a very is correct. I mean, I described before the ratio between phospho-tau and diabetic phospho-tau remains a very reliable marker in terms of distinction between Alzheimer and non-Alzheimer disease dementias. Also to examine the progression of MCI, I'm less convinced about what can give us for preclinical cases. But of course, it remains very a very interesting tool. One main limitation of CSF is the level of acceptance in elderly persons. And also, I was very surprised to see how easily elderly persons accept the idea of PET, despite the fact that it's not a really simple procedure, and are reluctant to the idea to have CSF, but definitely it's a very good one.
Thank you.
Okay. We don't have time, Professor, sorry. And in private, amazing. 2 minutes before we close. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And now.